Trinity, one God whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation.
Amen.
Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin together this morning. Reconciling God.
We confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us, through your love renew us, and in your spirit lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen.
Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope. For hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together this morning. O God,
with all your faithful followers of every age, we praise you, the rock of our life. Be our strong foundation. Inform us into the body of your Spirit that we may gladly minister to all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The reading this morning is from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. I myself, Paul, appeal to you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ. I, who am humble when face to face with you, but bold towards you when I'm away. I ask that when I am present, I need not show boldness by daring to oppose those who think we are acting according to human standards. Indeed, we live as human beings, but we do not wage war according to human standards. For the weapons of our warfare are not merely human, but they have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy our arguments and every proud obstacle raised up against the knowledge of God. And we take every thought captive to obey Christ. We are ready to punish every disobedience when your obedience is complete. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsive reading comes from Psalm 48, verses 3 through 7. God himself is in Jerusalem's towers, revealing himself as its defender.
The kings of the earth joined forces and advanced against the city.
But when they saw it, they were stunned.
They were terrified and ran away.
They were gripped with terror and writhed in pain like a woman in labor.
You destroyed them like the mighty ships of Tarshish shattered by a powerful east wind. All right, it is time for our children's message. So if you are young or young at heart, you are welcome to jump up close to the screen there. And if you would like to unmute, you are welcome to do that as well, the kids are. So we have a powerful message this morning from Paul, and I thought I would share with you guys about this powerful message. Paul says that we have a gift from God that helps us to blow things up. So sometimes kids like blowing things up, don't they? Like knocking things over and tearing them apart. And, oh, see, and Bridget just fell down. Sometimes you even knock yourself down with power, right? You don't even know how strong your own arms and legs are. And so you have some power even in your life. And I tell you what, I have a bomb here with me right now. Would you like to see it? It blows up. Are you ready? You know what kind of bomb this is? What is it?
A bath bomb?
Yeah, this blows up your bathtub, right? Have you guys ever blown up your bathtub?
Yes. Many.
Yeah, this one's pink and white with some swirls and sprinkles in it. So I'm not sure what kind of explosion it makes, but I'm guessing it's something very pink when it blows up, right? So this is a bath bomb, right? This is powerful. This changes your entire bathing experience. This one little ball right here can fill up a big bathtub. And if you think about it, my bathtub is bigger than the screen that I'm on right now. So like, if I put my hands this wide, that's not even part of my bathtub. My bathtub's like massive, right? And this one little thing can fill up my entire bathtub, like blow it up, boom, fizzy, right? Everywhere. That's really powerful. It's a lot of power in a very tiny package. And that's what Paul is saying this morning. He says the words of God, the gifts of the Spirit that you have, even as kids, are very powerful, enough to fill up a room with the understanding that God is present with us and that God loves us. So I wanted you to know, you guys are packing a big wallop this morning, even though you're a little bit younger. And I think you know that. There are things in your life that you have control over. You have powers. Sometimes you look at and go, ooh, I didn't know I could do that. And that's exactly the kind of thing Paul is telling us about the gifts of the Spirit. You have those within you as well. And I didn't want you to know, to feel left out when we talked about those powers this morning. They're a part of your existence too. They were gifted to you in your baptism and now a part of your life forever, a gift from God. And Paul says, hey, look at this, this wonderful thing that we've all got. We ought to celebrate it. So I wanted you guys to remember that the next time you knock something over or a little stronger than you thought or even the next time you launch one of these into your bathtub, or maybe at your brother and sister, because sometimes that happens when things are not going so well, right? So be careful of your own power, that you don't hurt others when you do it. Paul says our purpose is not to hurt others with our power, but to show them how powerful God is, and so we stand in his place as his helper. So I wanted to share that with you this morning, and I hope you would pray with me to close our time together. Can you do that?
Yeah.
All right, let's pray together then. Bow your heads, close your eyes, and here we go. Dear God.
Dear God.
We thank you.
We thank you.
For giving us.
For giving us.
Your power.
Your power.
To help us.
To help us.
And we pray.
And we pray.
That we.
That we.
Would use it.
Would use it.
To help others.
To help others.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
We pray.
We pray.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Thank you for coming up this morning. I appreciate it. You guys are great as always. We are going to move from here into the gospel acclamation and then the gospel reading. According to St. Mark, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
All right, so we have a powerful lesson this morning, not because of me, but because that's literally the word in Scripture that gets used over and over again this morning, both in 2 Corinthians and in the Gospel of Mark, and also as a reminder, kind of referenced a little bit in that Psalms text this morning, that powerful east wind that destroys a fleet. By the way, a little bit of Bible trivia for you. Nothing good ever comes out of the east in the Old Testament. That's where bad stuff comes from. And so if any time in the Psalm or in the Old Testament you hear about the east, it's bad stuff. So it doesn't really apply today, but back then that was part of just the culture, the mythos, you know, the thought process of what happened. Well, some stuff came in from the east, you know how that goes, right? So bad stuff came in and destroyed all these ships. It was an example of power, if you will. And that word power is actually really incredible. The word that Paul uses in 2 Corinthians, the word that gets used in the Greek in the Gospel of Mark, is the same word. It's actually a word in Greek that you guys know as well. You don't know that you know it, but you do. So I'm going to tell you, in the Greek, that root word is dunamis, and we use it today as the base word for something that you recognize or would if we had some cartoons on the screen right now, maybe some Wile E. Coyote or Yosemite Sam. You can imagine a bundle of sticks of dynamite rolled together with a fuse on them. That word dynamite comes from the Greek word dunamis, and it's the same word. That's how when Paul talks about having divine power, when Jesus has divine power, when there was power from the east, it is dynamite, literally dynamite. It is dunamis, the power that is wielded by God's Spirit. And Paul says that dunamis is something that we all share as well as a gift of our baptism, that we have God's power within each and every one of us. Now, the question, of course, is what we do with that power, right? Sometimes we use it for the right thing, and sometimes we use it for the wrong thing. Sometimes we're not quite as good about looking to reasons. And Paul is talking to the Corinthians kind of about that a little bit this morning. As you remember from the first half of the book of 2 Corinthians, Paul has mostly been talking about ways in which they can do ministry. But here in the second half of the book of Corinthians, Paul is talking to them about all the ways they're divided as a community, all the things that bring them apart, all the things that they're angry about, the discussions and disagreements that they've had, the factions that have risen among them. And so Paul is bringing forth the power of Christ and showing them that it overcomes disagreements. In fact, you might have caught in 2 Corinthians that little bit that Paul said, gosh, I wish I had that kind of power. Paul says the power of the Spirit is the power to destroy arguments. And I think we all wish we had that power. Like, we're discussing something with someone, we're arguing with them, we're like, man, if I just had the ability to crush their argument so they would listen to me for once, right? And that's kind of the power that we all desire. But Paul says that power is used for something specifically. He does say it's a power to destroy arguments, but it's a specific type of argument. It's an argument and a proud obstacle raised up against the knowledge of God. And so Paul says this power that we have as people of the Spirit is used in a particular capacity to clear out obstacles, to undermine arguments against knowing who God is. And we ourselves struggle with that too. We struggle with this image of God, and sometimes we have the wrong image of God in our hands. We do think about that dynamite power, that bath bomb, and that's the only image of God that we're able to conjure up. And I tell you what, there's something strange about us as human beings, which is when we have not done the right thing, when we're feeling guilty, when we're feeling broken, when we are anxious, when we are sad, that tends to be the picture of God that pops into our heads, the God who judges, the God who is wrathful, the God who is powerful. That's the first place that we end up going. And I think it's because of our brokenness and our guilt and our shame that we try to kind of distance ourselves away and shy away from God. But this is something a little different here. Paul has a different vision of God in mind. That God who destroys arguments and everything else is destroying arguments that are against the knowledge of God and who God is, who God really is in the person of Christ. That's what Paul would tell us, that God reveals himself to us most in the person of Christ. And Luther echoed this in the Reformation. People would ask him, where can I find God? And he would say, in the cross. That's where you can find God. If you want to know where Jesus is at, look to the cross. This is our knowledge of who God is. God is someone who sacrifices on our behalf. God is someone who gives for us. The opening song said it this morning, if you remember, right? You didn't want heaven without us, so you brought heaven down to us. Those are beautiful lyrics and a good representation of what Christ is doing on the cross, clearing away our sin and heartache and hardship with power, special power, power that destroys the arguments that we have against what God is doing. Arguments that say, I'm not worth it, or I have sinned too much, or I have done too many evil, terrible things, or I'm not worth redeeming, or I don't deserve to be redeemed, all of those things, or, you know, only the other person can forgive me, or only I can forgive myself. All of those are arguments against what Christ is doing on the cross. And Paul says the power of God breaks all of those arguments up, knocks them all away, until the only thing left is the vision of Christ dying and raising for us, clearing away all the dirt, all the sin, all the underbrush, giving us a new life. And Paul says something very interesting this morning as well. I don't know if you've caught it, but there's always been a little bit of an ironic twist for me. That very last verse in Corinthians, he says, we are ready to punish every disobedience, right? So he said, we have this power to destroy arguments, to take every thought captive to obey Christ. That sounds pretty radical as well, because I know that's not true of me yet. And I'm sure not true of you either, that every thought is captive to obeying what Christ wants. I would say a good number, a good percentage of my brain is still wired to do what I want and not what God wants, right? We can be pretty honest about that. So Paul says, that's the goal. We're moving to all of those things. And then he says, look, we are ready to punish your every disobedience, comma, when your obedience is complete. In other words, Paul is making a little bit of a joke here. He's saying, look, we're ready to bring the hammer down on you for your disobedience just as soon as you finish learning how to obey. you're not there yet. And you may not be this side of kingdom come, right? In fact, I would say that is who we are as people. We are irrevocably broken. Christ covers over that brokenness here, but it's not until the resurrection that we find the perfection that God intends for us. And so Paul is essentially saying, look, I know you're not fully obedient yet, and so I'm not going to punish you until I know that I won't have to punish you. Okay? I'm withholding that from you, which is in and of itself a demonstration of the power of God, the dunamis, the dynamite of God, which is to say that God is filled with grace. God passes over the things that we do. God leaves us unpunished when we most deserve it. And that is a scary thought to us. That is the kind of thing that takes us a moment to pause and consider. That's the true power of the Spirit, that power that destroys strongholds. And you can imagine dynamiting the walls of a fortress and then just being blown to pieces, right? God blows up our defenses because we raise them when we do terrible things, and God says, I'm going to leave this unpunished. And we get scared. We say, that's not how it's supposed to work. We're supposed to be taken under for the things that we do wrong. And for some reason, God shows us grace instead. And in that moment of pause, as we ponder what this is, this grace and forgiveness that we've received, something else is happening on the inside of us. Our hearts are being changed. You see, when we're punished for the things that we do wrong, when we disobey, as Paul talks about here, our punishment changes our actions. But what changes our heart? What makes for lasting change? And the vision of Christ on the cross, the gift of forgiveness and grace, that's what changes hearts. That's what changes us on the inside. That is truly the power of God, the power of Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit, that it is so dynamite that it can change even the hardened hearts that sit within us. And that's the gift that we truly receive in our baptism, the gift that we are reminded of when we study God's word together, the gift that all of us here together share in as the people of God, this dynamite gift that God lights a fuse on underneath the rock-solid foundation of our heart, breaking us open to receive love and grace and to remind us of the figure of Christ. This is a power that does destroy all the ships of Tarshish from the east, that rocks every foundation that we have, but it's not meant to destroy us. It's meant to free us. Remember, the walls of Jericho fell outward, not inward, right? This is something that busts things loose within us when this dynamites our foundations and our walls. It frees us. It sends us out into other people, because when we receive that grace and that forgiveness and our hearts are changed, something changes in us as we react to other people. We find our hearts are softer than them. We find that, like Paul, we are willing to offer grace and forgiveness where we were not willing to offer that before because of what God has done for us. Maybe that's what Jesus meant when he said, take up your cross and follow me. Be willing also to sacrifice, to give grace to others, to forgive and pass over their every disobedience until they too, through the power of the Spirit, have knowledge of who God is and have begun to have their thoughts be taken captive by this gift of Christ, this grace that we receive that is undeserved. Thanks be to him for that gift this morning and for that reminder in the person of Christ. For people like Paul, who also share their wisdom with us, their power with us, and remind us of who it is that God is and how that same power that was in him also resides in us. Amen.
Save the town.
Together with the whole church, let us confess our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
This time we will take your prayer requests. You can use the chat box, again, that's at the bottom of your screen in the center, or if you're on a phone or iPad. There should be three little dots that show your menu. If you tap that, you can also then tap the chat function and bring it up. And we'll give you a second to kind of throw those into the chat box. And I'm going to call those out as they come in to give Joan a chance to write them down before she leads us through those prayers in just a moment. So again, that time of prayer request is open, so just drop them in chat and we will go from there. Our first one today coming in from Ed, for Marion Sun and her family. Marion's husband, Ted, passed away on Wednesday after a very brief time in hospice, and her and her family are mourning. You guys saw the announcements, or will see the announcement if it hasn't come out yet, about visitation on Tuesday. Next one, prayers for John as he was furloughed from his job. So we will keep John Carson in her prayers. The Davenports ask for prayers for Bonnie and her family, Eva and her family, and also for a friend who is recovering from surgery. Judy asked for prayers this morning for her friend Deborah. She's looking for a good bone scan, healing, remission of cancer, a lot of different things going on with her right now. We also have prayers from Jeff and Nancy. They asked for continued prayers for the recovery of their friend Mary's heart surgery. Surgery was successful, so we're just looking for good recovery. Eric asked for prayers for Bill Griffith. And then John Cherry for prayers for Shelley, sister-in-law healing after bone marrow transplant. Prayers for Ileana, battling cancer, and for Eric, battling MS. Those come in from Doreen. Ginger asks for prayers for Bill, who is in ICU, suffering from COVID. David's father, suffering from severe chronic back pain. Also from Judy for Larray, who is doing clinical residency in South Georgia, for safe travel to location and safety as she works from COVID. Kate asks for prayers for her cousin Amanda, starting college in person tomorrow. She's nervous and excited both. And then John also asks for Linda's healing from brain injury. And another one from Judy, successful procedure for Kathy. And Christina says prayers of gratitude for KL on the confirmation that health issues are minor and treatable. So a lot of good prayers this morning. And I hope Joan had a fast pen hand writing all those down. Joan, do you need another moment or are you good?
I think I'm good. If I missed anyone, please forgive me and call their name silently in your heart.
Also, Joan, one last one for all those affected by the hurricanes that came in this week. So.
Got it. Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of faithfulness, you bid your people to follow Jesus. Set the mind of your church on divine things. Grant us trust in you, that though we lose our lives for the sake of Christ, we thereby discover joy in life through him. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of wonder, the earth is yours and all that is in it. Heal your creation and give us eyes to see the world as you do. As the seasons change, pattern the rhythm of our lives in harmony with all creation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of all nations, you call us to live peaceably with all. Give us ears to hear one another, even those we name as enemies. Fill our leaders with mercy and understanding, that they advocate and genuinely care for those who are poor and most vulnerable in our communities. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of salvation, you promised to deliver us. Give to those who suffer a strong sense of your presence and love. Accompany those who are uncertain. Raise the spirits of those who are despairing and heal the sick. We especially ask for your comfort for Mary Tan and her family, for John, for all the victims of the recent hurricane, for Bonnie and her family, for Eva and her family. Be with Deborah, Mary, Bill, Shelley, Liana, Eric, Bill, Lorraine, Amanda, Linda, and Kathy. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of community, you call us to rejoice in hope, to be patient in suffering, and to persevere in prayer. Make our congregation a workshop of your love. When we quarrel, bring reconciliation. Help us overcome evil with good. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of grace, you give us everlasting life. In love, we recall your holy ones who now live with you in undying life. And we remember Ted Tan. In remembering, we have a foretaste of the feast to come. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us together pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Okay, we're about to enter into our time of passing the peace, and during that time, we invite you to unmute, turn on your camera, share greetings with everyone. But before we get to that, just some announcements this week. Be looking for these people in the service today, so you can pass congratulations and happy birthdays on to them. Evan, Josh, and Corey, the triplets, celebrating a birthday today. Also Cordelia and Marley. And Margot and Claudia. So happy birthday to all of you celebrating this week. And also congratulations, happy anniversary to Jeff and Nancy and to Philip and Barbara. So congratulations to you guys as well. Again, you're welcome to unmute or utilize the chat box. You can send a message to everyone or use the drop-down box to send specific greetings to someone. And this time is open to you. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
All right. I'm going to call out some of the chat greetings as we go, too. So first of all, congratulations, Jeff and Nancy.
Peace.
Hey, peace. I heard the voice, but I don't see the face. Oh, there we go. I see you.
Daddy, say peace. Say peace.
Peace be with you.
Happy anniversary.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you, everybody.
Peace. Peace with everyone.
Peace, Chris.
Solstice have a little different background today. Peace be with you guys. Peace, David, I see you. To the burn side.
With you.
All right. Also coming in from the chat, from Judy, from Heather, from Karen, from Mary Beth, from the Davenports, from Chris, from the Jackmans, from my two daughters down in the basement, streaming from there. Shelly and Hervasio send greetings, Doreen as well. So awesome, we got a crowd this morning. You guys were a little late rolling out of bed, but you showed up once we got going, didn't you? Kate and Bridget, I see you down there.
You're looking comfortable as always, Ed, and you're lazy boy.
It's a good gig being the music director when everything's on Zoom. By Sunday morning, you can just kind of... In the middle of the week when the recording is going on, that's when Ed is a little stressed and not in his lazy boy.
Music was beautiful again awesome. Today.
Yes.
Thank you. I would have the lazy boy, you know, if I could.
All right. Well, glad to have all of you on. We are going to move next into our time of offering. So you have a couple of options if you would like to give an offering this morning. The first is through PayPal. We have a short link, paypal.me/POPLC. The second one is through Venmo. If you do that, there's a QR code there. You can shoot that with your phone, and it will drop into our landing page, or you can use our handle, which is POP Lutheran Church. If you prefer to do online bill pay, you can do that as well, or you can send a check to the church. We do have someone up there, at least one person, rotating days, so we make sure that there's an eye on the building and that mail is coming in and being secured, so you're welcome to still do that as well. And again, thank you to all of you. You've been very generous. We're doing great financially, despite the pandemic and everything going on, so I appreciate that. And again, if things have changed for you and now is not a time you can give, that is okay. No, nothing wrong with that. We know things have changed for a lot of different people. So while you guys have a minute or two to do that, we're going to enjoy an offertory song this morning. And here we go. Together this morning.
God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us through these gifts that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song. Amen.
This time, we will engage in the rite of spiritual communion. Since we cannot be together in person, we invite you at home to follow along with the gold as you do for the rest of the congregation. And here we go. Blessed be God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom now and forever.
Amen.
Let the power of the Holy Spirit come upon us, O Lord, to mercifully cleanse our hearts and defend us from all adversities through Christ our Lord. Behold, Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come into you and eat with you, and you with me. Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. In union, blessed Jesus, with the faithful gathered at the altar of your church, wherever your blessed body and blood are offered this day, we long to offer you praise and thanksgiving for creation and all the blessings of this life, for the redemption won for us by your life, death, and resurrection, for the means of grace, and for the hope of glory. And particularly for the blessings given us today, Lord, the technology to be gathered here together, the smiling faces I see on the screen, and this opportunity to share a meal with you.
I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. And since I cannot at this time receive communion, I pray that you come into my heart. I unite myself with you and embrace you with all my heart, my soul, and my mind. Let nothing separate me from you. Let me serve you in this life until, by your grace, I come to your glorious kingdom and unending peace. Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in our hearts in the fullness of your strength. Be our wisdom and guide us in right pathways. Conform our lives and actions to the image of your holiness. And in the power of your gracious might, rule over every hostile power that threatens or disturbs the growth of your kingdom. You, Jesus, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, living and reigning, one God in glory everlasting. Amen. So I'm going to do the benediction, and then we have closing song, and then I'm going to go through a couple of the announcements with everyone. So don't be so quick quite to log off, and then, of course, if you do want to linger after announcements, we'll have a little bit of a time of fellowship for all of you. But before we do that, our benediction for the day. If you know the motions, you can follow along with me at home. And now may God go before us to show us the way, behind us to encourage us, beside us to befriend us, above us to watch over us, beneath us to lift us up, and within us to give us the grace, mercy, and peace of his Son and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to serve our risen Lord.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.